Animation's smooth and still. We're back. Finn and
We're
I
back.
are in the studio whipping up some beats on that mic.
Beats. Love it.
Episode 17 now.
Of course, flying, isn't
it? It is flying. We did a nice little topical one last one on the episode 16. Watch that on the YouTube if you missed that, or on Spotify or other audio softwares. Unfortunately, though, it's only us two today. No guests.
Unfortunately, mate, this is a plus.
I feel like people like that special sort of guest vibe, though.
Nah, you're right. But it's just not, it's not, I don't think it's a bad thing.
Nah, I don't think it's a bad thing. We can hold our own.
For sure.
The funny thing I was watching the other day was the one where we did Dom, when it was me, you and Dom on the folklore. Yeah. There was so many bits where we just burst into like tears. Just from...
Alright, I mean... I'll say it. Let's get Dom on again.
Let's go.
Let's invite him back.
I was because I watched it all through and did some clips from it. It's just hilarious. I've got a montage of us just laughing. Oh, it's hilarious.
Too much funny. It's too funny, to be fair. That, mate, it was that fucking moment with
the Beast of Bodmin.
Beast of Bodmin, mate. The fucking cat. Oh. Yeah. But, yeah, Dom literally cracking up. Even when I was trying to take it. I was trying to take things serious. Like, I was getting deep into like the folklore shit, and he was just like stares, like, and I completely just mugged me off. But there we are.
The funny one for me as well was is the stairs break on.
I don't get the whole thing about the stairs.
No, it's just the fact that it's just like. The way you were pumping it up, we were like, fuck, it's going to be a scary creature.
And I told you it was stairs from the beginning.
Nah, there was a big delay. You were like, you said like, oh, I'm going to argue the point that I do believe it, just to make it sound more realistic.
Yeah, but that was after I told you it was staircase.
Oh,
but,
was it?
You can't, but like, that's the thing. It seems benign, but I think it's like, that's why it's scary. Like, no, it's just a bit off.
Yeah, I agree. Like, if I saw stairs, I wouldn't fuck with them. Like, in the middle, randomly
see,
in the middle woods.
Mate, I'm
I
in
agree.
Your head now.
You're
if you
are
go
my
in the
head.
Woods now, and you see a set of stairs, I promise you, you will not touch them, will you? You won't fuck with them.
Well, you said the first stair is fine, right? You just get... You can't hear the... It said,
No. Just don't... The top is the worst.
Yeah, I'm not doing odds on for that. Today's episode, though, we're talking about social media and why... Why are you social media? That's the title, I think. Yeah, why are you social media?
Is it?
Yeah, that's the title. I mean, we'll go into specifics, obviously, within that episode, or within this episode, on what we mean. I think social media is a really interesting topic because it's fairly new in terms of, just in terms of use. It's over the last decade, right? Twitter was like 2000.
Facebook was 2000. It was like, well, I mean... It had like different iterations, but hold on. Oh, no, that's bright.
Before Facebook and that, it was MySpace, right? I mean, that was before our time, unfortunately.
Yeah,
but
course.
MySpace was 2003.
We didn't. But I think Facebook launched like this, revolution of social media.
Yeah, 100%.
Where it started to kick off this whole different thing.
Remember, Blackberries.
2007, right? Blackberries, yeah, I remember Blackberries.
Blackberry Messenger?
What do you mean, BBM? Is that BBM?
Yeah, BBM. That was a big phase. I didn't get Blackberry, too fair.
I had a brick for, like, a long, long time.
Yeah.
I was not on social media for a very long time. Like, I was really against it, actually. Personally. But obviously, I didn't think like, it was a bad thing. I just didn't want to get involved. I just felt like it was just like overcomplicating and just sort of like just lacking in privacy. So I didn't really fancy it. So I just didn't have any form of social media at all until year 10, where I got a Facebook just for like Facebook Messenger, basically. So didn't use Facebook at all, just used Facebook Messenger just because that was like what? Me and my mates were using it at the time to like message,
Yeah.
Whatever we're doing, but before that, yeah. So I had a brick up until that point, pretty much. So it was as soon as I got like a touch screen phone or a smartphone, when I got, you know, Facebook and Facebook Messenger. But before that, I had the brick. I had a BlackBerry for a really short stint before I sat on it and broke the keypad. And one of the keys that broke on the keypad was one that I needed for my password.
No.
Yeah, and I mean, I know I could have reset it, but then also, like, I just still had a broken keypad, and I just couldn't. I just wanted. I literally, it was like a month off new, so I was just like, "Fuck it, I'll forget about that," and I just went back to the old brick until I got the touchscreen.
What was your first touchscreen one?
So it was like a Motorola.
Motorola. Oh my god.
It was a shitty Motorola. I actually reckon you know what? Saying that, I actually reckon I still have it. I might even have it in here.
Why would you have it there?
I don't know, actually.
Hold on. But one of the first messaging apps that I used, I remember it was like year four, maybe year five, was obviously, I can't say obviously, was MSN. Did you use that? It was like, MSN Messenger or something?
Yeah, I didn't use it at all.
Oh, that was weird, man. That was some weird times.
Did you have it?
Yeah. That was the times where, yeah, this was definitely primary school, and it was like, the club. I remember playing Club Penguin, messaging people from school.
Yeah. I played Club Penguin, mate.
Oh, mate, that was some weird times thinking back.
Was it?
Yeah.
See, I genuinely don't, it's weird now, because I am, like, social media-wise, we're very connected, you know? All these different ways, and all these different faces of social media that each people have. They all provide different ways to reach out to each other and connect with each other, like all these different mediums. So it's pretty weird to think back then you either had like you know one sort of very like not very accessible or usable like link way to communicate with people, or maybe even like in my case until year 10, I literally didn't have any social media. Like when I left my mates, that was it. It's weird now, because literally, if I need to talk to a mate, I'm just sending them a message, sending them a Snapchat, sending them an Instagram message or whatever, and it's just there. And then the fact that I could just, back in the day before that, I just had no issues with going home and just being like, cool. And if I wanted to get hold of them, I would, you know, ding up their little fucking, their number in my brick, ring them up. Just bell them, or just like send them a little message, which would spend me about 10 minutes to compose. So it's pretty crazy how it's all evolved, and it's all very full on, like very quickly. That's how I feel.
It's very quick, because if you think about it, remember, so you said, you used to call your mates. So now, yeah, let's say you're outside someone's house, you won't go ring the bell, you won't call them, you'll say, really? Here, on Snapchat or something.
Yeah.
And it's crazy how that's evolved really quickly. Like, if we look at the last 10 years, like, if we go back to 2010, what social media is about? Facebook and maybe Twitter, but that's the early stages. There was no Instagram, there was no Snapchat that I can remember.
Yeah, I mean,
I just remember Facebook, and that was like the bare bones. That was like Farmville, like the Facebook games. I remember playing Farmville. Definitely like 2009, 2010 vibes.
I never played any of those, but I know what you mean. I think I know what you mean. But yeah, I just... Well, I think it was definitely a big leap for me when it went from, so I just, if I wanted to, I didn't really text much at all either, like at all. I wasn't a big texter. I wasn't a big caller. So social media wasn't necessary for me, because a lot of the time people, you know, social media messaging, instant messaging was a good way to get around, you know, your phone bill. So your contract prices or your pay to go prices. So you just, you know, you get Facebook, you message on there instead, but obviously you need Wi-Fi and, back then, 3G, 4G, bit spotty.
Wait, there wasn't even 4G, was there? It was only 3G.
Nah.
Yeah.
So 4G probably came around where we live. I want to say like 2014, maybe 2013, maybe.
Yeah.
2014, probably. That's a guess. But that feel. I think that's about when it was, because that was when I got my first upgrade. I can't remember, actually. Because I didn't upgrade from that bad, awful Motorola touchscreen smartphone for a few years until I got my phone that I have before this one. So I've not gone through many phones in my time.
Wow.
Yeah. I've had 3 smartphones ever.
I've had 3 as well, I think. Maybe 4, actually.
Maybe that's normal.
Because if you think about it, the contracts that I usually get are 2 years. So for this phone here, I have a 2-year contract. So,
right.
Obviously, 3 phones is 6 years of my life, and I've only been using a phone since 20. Yeah, for about 9 years. So that one phone was like my first phone was like a Rio 2. Remember, like Rio is a weird brand.
Yeah, I kind of remember.
That was my first phone, and then obviously I got a smartphone. So it was about 20. I got a smartphone in year 9.
Right.
And that's when my sort of social media relevancy sort of came about. I don't want to say relevancy, but when I became usage of because I remember that's when I opened up an Instagram, a Snapchat. I was already on Facebook. Actually, I got a funny story. So Facebook, yeah, you know my account on Facebook.
Yeah.
That's not actually like my account. So basically, my mum had Facebook, and you had to be 13 to play. So I wanted to play Farmville, so I just used her account to play Farmville. But I used to use it so much, I was like, once I turned 13, I was like, fuck it, I'm just gonna change it to mine. So eventually, I changed my mum's Facebook to mine. Bevin to me. That's good.
That's so strange. What the fuck? Yeah. That's pretty. It's a strange story, mate. Can't lie. So you got Snapchat straight away?
Yeah, because I checked recently. You know, you can check like when you joined apps and stuff on Snapchat. It told me I joined in 2013. That's long ago, bro. Ooh,
that is ages. What?
How did you?
To be fair, I think I joined in quite early, but I wasn't like a big user really.
Yeah, look, 20th of July, 2013. That is mad.
So long ago. What the fuck?
That was nearly 7 years ago.
That's 7 years almost.
Hold on, Saskia's informed me she will be joining the podcast. So we are having a guest.
I'd love to get an insight from her on this one. That should be interesting. But yeah. Especially if she's younger, so she's.
I was gonna say 4-year difference. That's...
Yeah, she. But I wonder, like, because maybe she will. Maybe because the technology came about as we were becoming, you know,
teenagers.
So we were teenagers when the technology came around, but she would have had that before then. So you know, it was when we were like 14, 13 when the iPhone, like, well, the iPhone 3 was already out, but it wasn't really like a. You know, Apple was still sort of picking up speed. It was the iPhone 4, I think, was when, you know, like, everyone our age, in, like, I don't know if it was year 8 or 9 or 10, but everyone our age was suddenly picking up iPhones.
Literally, as soon as the iPhone, everyone was like, phew. I was like, how the fuck
everyone's
is...
Everyone's getting that square iPhone, that little square iPhone, and everyone's on iMessage, everyone's on all of that, and it just became this whole thing.
We have participant. We have guests.
Wait, what? Am I in there?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, the microphone's a bit not good, though.
Oh, I'm so confused. I don't understand what this is. Ooh. Wait, can you see me or not?
No.
How the hell do I turn...
Can you use a different microphone? Ooh.
It's so loud.
Welcome.
Oh, sorry. I don't have... Like, oh. What is happening? I literally don't know how to use this. What's going on? What is this? I feel like an old person trying to work a phone. I don't understand. Why is it so small on my screen? No. Sorry, I'm having technical difficulties.
Oh, God. I don't know what's worse. This or Harley joining?
It's piercing.
We can turn her down to her.
All right. Okay, sorry.
Use those admin powers.
How do I...
No, you have to turn her down individually.
Okay.
You're on 50% roughly.
Alright. I've not been that harsh, but
alright, welcome.
Hello.
To the topic. Bienvenue. Topic of why social media? Why are you using it? Why do you use social media? Why is it relevant in your life?
Me?
No, that's just the general topic. But we were talking about
okay.
how
Yeah, I was watching. You were talking about your phones.
We were talking about 2013 times where
back in their day.
Child at 2013, so
yeah, that's pretty. That's, I mean, but when, so Saskia, when did you get your first smartphone?
Oh god, I actually don't know. I got my first like proper phone, I guess. I mean, it was a Samsung.
Still,
at, like year six or year five.
What?
That's what I mean. You know what I mean? That's what I mean. I could tell.
I know, but like, it's, I didn't technology. Have any apps on it at all, and it was my mum's old one, and it was really bad, and it was almost like a brick phone. Like, it was so bad. It was like really embarrassing.
That's strange. Because I was thinking, you know, like, technology-wise, we picked it up pretty much as soon as it was available, right? Our generation.
Yeah.
Or our year, definitely. Our age. Like, because it was when the iPhone dropped, people obviously picked it up. But before that, it was all BlackBerry, like, big on BlackBerry, nothing else.
Yeah.
It was mad. It's mad now that there's this huge divide between Android and Apple.
That was never a thing.
Yeah, literally, like, it was not a thing until suddenly everyone's got an Apple phone, and anyone who doesn't is a weirdo. Pretty much. But yeah, it was all quite sudden, because, I mean, like you say, you got like Instagram. So did you get Instagram, Spencer? Did you got Instagram?
I think I remember getting Instagram. I remember my first post was, I mean, I can check my first post. I remember I've archived it now, but it was, I was definitely in school, and I was definitely year 9, at least.
Really?
I might have been even, like, might have been year 8, mate.
That's so weird to me. I don't think, you know what, I'll check for you. I'll check when my first Instagram post is.
Oh, no, so I was year 9, yeah, I was year 9.
All right.
Wait, is that right? 2015? No, hold on. I was year 10, sorry, I lied, year 10.
I've deleted some.
Oh, yeah, no, I've deleted them, yeah, of course. No, I was definitely year 9, yeah.
Because I think my first one was, like, 2016.
So, that was when we finished GCSEs.
Yeah, I got that around then. Because I think it was just, I genuinely believe Instagram was just, like, people to share, like, pictures of food and that.
Yeah, no, I remember having that weird thing as well, because Instagram wasn't that big at first, was it? It was like, it was a platform that we obviously didn't know what was on it at first, and there's just memes of like food and shit going around. I mean, memes weren't even a thing either.
I thought it was just people who took pictures of their nice food before they ate it, and then like, I don't know, basically like Facebook, but just like more concentrated on the images, and I basically just didn't care. So I was like, all right, I'm not going to get it. And then, like, everyone's got one, and everyone's posting pictures of themselves looking nice, and that brings up, you know, this whole other issue. Like, all these doctored images, or not even doctored, but just sort of, like, images that are very selective and show the very best sides of people, and it's all very, like, pristine and very well put, like, well framed and well structured, which is quite, like, strange, because, like, you look at some people who you know personally, you look at their account and like how well structured it is and how well presented they are outwardly on Instagram and stuff like that. And it's not, obviously, I'm not tearing at anyone at all. I'm literally just an observation. And I mean, I have Instagram as well. I post pictures of myself and that. So, you know, but I'm just saying that it's weird when you look at that and you see such like a specific outwardly projected personality that they have depict through their pictures on Instagram, and then you know them personally to be completely different.
Yeah, so this is a thing. So this is I don't want to say it's not like an, I was gonna say alter ego, but like it's almost like someone has an internet persona,
yeah,
and then their own persona, and it's weird, yeah. Like, because they're usually called like fakes, aren't they? I mean, if you look at a lot of it's like vlogging, like, you know, like vlogging. Like, that person that you see that you're watching is entertaining you. That's not their full true self, you know? They're putting on a persona. Yeah. It's like a comedy show, or not even a comedy show, just like, a TV show back in the day, like Victorious, or... they're all playing characters, you know? They're just playing characters.
Yeah. Basically acting. Acting,
yeah,
but
I don't know why I didn't say acting, but yeah.
Right. It's acting, but on a more personal level. Like,
yeah, because
they are not, yeah, you know, they're not playing... this character completely separate from themselves, who's got completely different personality, etc., and they got to dress up for it and pretend to be a completely different person. But it is, you know, it is abstracted from their personal beliefs and thoughts, etc., because, you know, they're not going to be their unfiltered self on camera for a vlog, for something that's being put out into the world, for something that they might want to, you know, they might want to change the way they act to be a certain way for their viewers, etc. So obviously it's not.
And I still find that to this day, we are still seeing more and more people like that. It's almost like with this new like TikTok revelation as well, people are like,
do you have it?
Of course I have TikTok. Yeah, bro. I make TikToks, mate. That shit's fun.
No, you don't.
Yeah, bro.
Don't.
That shit's fun. Mate, next time I see you, we'll get hooked on it. Trust.
No, I'm not downloading it. I refuse to.
Yeah, yeah. We'll just use my one. We'll make some.
What? Saskia's looking disgusted.
What? She's made them with me.
TikTok is so good.
Let's go.
I'm on the weird side, though. I get some weird stuff, like, come on my feed. It's so weird. Like, babies, like, flying in the air. Not real babies, obviously, but, like dolls, like, fly. It's weird. You either have, like, the side, the boring side with, like, all the TikTok dances, and then you have the other side, and it's just weird. It's, yeah.
That sounds so strange. I get what you mean, though. I think Instagram has the same kind of thing. Like, it has, you know, everyone's personal Instagrams where they're, you know, doing their nice photos where they're dressing up for prom or dressing up for going out, picture with the girls or out with the lads, out the footy. And then there's, you know, the meme. Well, now there's meme pages. But I don't know about you lot. I follow a lot of meme pages.
Oh,
and
same.
That is pretty much my feed. I love it. Like, it's funny because I don't even know why I follow a lot of people. Because when I look through my list, and I'm like, oh, yeah, I went to school with her. I went, you know, I used to play football with him. And then I see a picture they post, and I just, like, straight past it. I don't want to like it. I have no interest in it. And then someone posts a meme, and I'm just like, yeah, mate, I love it. I like it. I like it. I'll save it. I'll send it to my mates.
I mean, I don't know what to comment on that, because I agree with you. I follow memes, but if I see people that I used to know, and I follow them still, I guess we can all talk about this whole like feature where there's a big sort of, I mean, Instagram are trying to remove it, right, weren't they? Like, they have removed the names in some countries because,
really?
yeah, because they don't, because seeing the number of likes you get is dangerous because of, it's like that, it links to instant gratification where people are posting these pics just to get a certain number of likes. And then luckily, Finn, we weren't a part of this, but during secondary school now, popularity is done a lot of the time online. Like, people...
Do you actually think it is, like, that, like, mirrored, though?
I think it is. If you think about it, right, think about all the popular people in school. I guarantee you they'll have the most amount of likes and stuff because the evidence of this is they're going to be more sociable, right? So they're going to be finding more people and adding them on Instagram. So therefore, their numbers are going to be higher and they're going to have more likes because they have a bigger reach.
But I don't know. I think it'll be, because it's like, do you genuinely think that they go into school and then, you know, there's a guy who got 124 likes on his last post and then some other guy who he's mates with got like 28 and then the guy who got way more likes is just getting more attention generally, specifically because people see that he's got more likes.
No, it's not specifically, it's just correlated. The fact that people that are popular in school or just popular in general will have more followers because they're more sociable and will get more likes there, because of that. But what I'm trying to say is the reason they're trying to remove it is because it's like a game of comparing yourself. Like when you're in school and you see, you we didn't go through this, but my sister's age and people coming through the school system now, they're gonna have Instagram and social media a lot more. And people, let's say introverts, right? I was an introvert in school, like there's many other introverts who didn't use social media. Exactly, who didn't use social media as much. And let's say, I'm not saying that we did, but people do compare themselves a lot on social media. And so let's say they post a photo, they get like 30 likes compared to some other people they see. Oh, 100, 90, 150, you know? It makes them feel a bit shit about themselves because they think, what am I not doing? What am I wrong? You know, why am I wrong? And that's why that's one of the reasons why they're trying to remove the number of likes on
Which is unhealthy.
Yeah, because it's an unhealthy comparison. Like,
it's always been unhealthy, though. I don't know
why. It always has.
They're just sort of saying that it, like, it's clearly... I get the whole idea that... But doesn't it feel strange? Because imagine being the designer and be like, okay, look, what we're going to do, right? People post pictures. And they're like, all right, sick. Share pictures. You comment on the pictures. That's nice. Cool. We get interaction. You can like a picture. Like, all right, okay. And you get a number. You know, you can track, you can tally, and you can view who's liked your picture, and you can see the number of people who liked your picture. And it's just like, all right, okay. Obviously, like, Facebook did it first, because Facebook's branched off into Instagram.
Yeah. Well, if Facebook owns Instagram.
Yeah, exactly. Same parent company. So, but the idea that, you know, you're pressing a button and you're giving someone an extra digit, but then it's just got this very real effect on them. You know, when you get it's this rush of, is it endorphin?
Yeah, it's endorphins, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, you get that endorphin rush and you're like, okay, I just want more. You're like, cool, that's awesome. I just want more now. And then you start craving it, and then it's all suddenly like, it's bringing in this quite an, I think it brings in quite an unhealthy mindset into social media, where it's no longer about, you know, just sharing photos between friends and seeing what other people have up for offer. It's just, you know, it's like you said, it's like a numbers game. It's a competition, and it's all based on statistics. Like, if you don't, you know, there's people who put up a picture, and if they don't get a certain number of likes within an hour, they'll delete it. And that seems crazy to me, because it's just like you're doctoring your image to get the most approval from people who, you know, don't, who you probably don't interact with daily or very much at all. Like, obviously your mates will like it and you'll interact with them very much, but most of the likes are coming from people you probably don't talk to at all, like talk to daily at all, talk to see.
Yeah.
So it's the fact that you're changing what's representative of yourself on the internet, on social media, for those people that seem so strange.
Yeah, like you said, whenever you click a double tap, that's another like, right? And I think it's because one like equates to one person, or sometimes robot or whatever. But you do, when you're in school, those people that you have on Instagram are obviously in the school, and there's no matter what, there's always going to be a hierarchy in life of popularity, whether you like it or not. That's always going to be a thing. I feel like it's almost impossible to remove, because unfortunately, it's in people's genes. Like, some people are just introverts; they don't want to socialize. That's fair enough. And some people are extroverts. You know, it's just how it is. And so, this whole liking thing has gone out of control, because, in my opinion, as soon as a platform becomes monetized, that's when it gets out of control. Because that's when advertisers look at stats like likes and engagements, and that's how you get money off posts. That's how meme posts get, you know, people approaching them and giving them money to advertise their product, etc. Because they have a lot of likes on their page. They have a lot of engagement with an audience, you know. I think there's obviously positives, like meme communities. We didn't know what memes were without Instagram. Memes came about in what, like 2017, 20, like proper good ones, didn't
they? No.
2016, 2017.
Well, no, but memes have been shared, you know, through other resources for a very long time.
Yeah, but like shit memes. Instagram.
Well, I mean.
Okay. Perspective, yeah.
But I think it's just that, I mean, obviously, we're having a deep chat on memes. What are we doing?
Because it's relevant. It's relevant.
Yeah, but I think it's just the whole thing that Instagram is ideal, because memes are just images and usually,
or videos,
you know, you don't really, all you want to do is just like them or save them.
Yeah.
And it's different to, it's weird because it's this blend of like social and commercial, like you said, with the whole monetizing of pages. So people are posting memes for money. How crazy is that? You're making money off a meme page.
Yeah,
making money off making jokes on the internet. And then other people are just, you know, posting pictures of their dogs or with their family, and it's a reflection of their, you know, personal life, etc. But this guy's just posting random memes just to entertain people. So it's this whole, it's weird because it's quite like an eclectic mix of different things, people with different ideas of how to use it, and yet it's all crammed into this one feed.
And it just links to Instagram now with these meme pages creating communities in a way, right? Because this meme page now has, let's say, 1.1 million followers. That's a yep. community of people that are appreciating the memes that are going on the page every day. And and I do agree, like, or I do... Oh, she's rage quit.
Stas has had enough.
She's had enough. Hello?
This fucking boring podcast.
What was I saying? No! Oh, I lost my train of thought. That's furious. I had a good point as well. But, oh, no, here we go. So, obviously, a person runs that meme page, right? And it's hard work. Like, let's be honest. Posting, like, 5 to 10 memes a day is long because you have to find the meme. You have to format it onto Instagram. I mean, you can argue.
A lot of time it's just stolen.
I agree. Of course it is. But it's the consistency that's hard because a lot of things in life is all about consistency, right? Like, if I ask you, like, are you consistent with your workout?
What do you mean?
I'm asking, are you consistent with a good workout?
Oh, the gyms are closed, fam.
It doesn't matter. Like, my point is, it's like, if people are running these Instagram pages and they have the internet, they're not going to say, oh, shout out the internet. They will find a way to post these memes, like, to keep that consistency going. It's all about, like...
That's just going into business practice.
Okay, that's going into business, fuck that. But then, what I'm saying is, the reason why the monetary values come involved is because, one... These platforms have become so big. Like, Facebook has over 1.5 billion monthly users, which is, I can't remember, like 20, is that 20% of the world? Like, 8 billion?
Well, there's almost 8 billion in the world now.
Roughly like 19-20% of the world uses that app, so monthly. So obviously, advertisers would want to...
That's a huge amount of
exactly.
monthly.
Exactly.
Sure.
Yeah.
Is that not just total created accounts?
That's definitely like... Sass, you good?
Sorry, yeah, what the hell is happening to my laptop? My Wi-Fi is like really weird, so that's connected to my phone, sorry.
Bro, you will not believe this.
What?
You want another number on Facebook?
What?
Fuck me, 2.6 billion monthly active users.
Get out.
Holy fuck.
That's ridiculous.
That is insane. That's 30% of the world, yeah. It makes sense, though.
How many people in the world actually just have access to internet, right?
More than you think, Tuva.
I read a stat that
more people have phones than they have houses. Like, live in houses.
Yeah, but that's believable.
Yeah, I guess.
I mean, that's just silly to, like, compare, because...
That's
although
nuts,
I understand
mate.
The sentiment, you know, phones are far cheaper and far more accessible than...
So anyways, back to my point. Obviously, this is key for, like... This is why money has become involved, because... TV used to be we used to sit down on TV, watch TV. Do you watch TV anymore?
Yeah.
No. Like, who the fuck watches TV? No, you don't.
I watch TV.
Maybe, like, sports events, but not sure.
When am I uni, I watch TV.
Oh, I guess maybe because it's more communal thing. But, like, most of the time, people have Netflix, everything's digital. That's not my point. So, like, the reason why this become monetized is because so many people are obviously using the apps.
And also, just, like, in general, social media and technology, current technology and... The ability to get what you want when you want it and watch what you want when you want is giving us this idea that we can have whatever, whenever. And we've got this whole short attention span thing where, you know, we want something now, we don't want something tomorrow. Stuff like Prime Now. Imagine you can order something, you can order an item and it can be delivered the very same day, you know, taken out of the warehouse.
That's nuts.
Given to a courier, drives to you, gives it to you, and you, like, it's a few hours. And you've got it. It's that same thing. That's mad.
Whoa. Why is there echo? That's...
Beep? Echo?
Yeah.
Feedbacks.
Nah, it's right now. It's right now. You just got to keep speaking.
You know what, Well, let's go on. All right, let's ask... I want to bring Saskia into the conversation. So, I was going to ask you, Saskia. How do you decide what you post on Instagram?
This is deep.
I don't actually know. I don't know why I post on Instagram. I don't really like social media because it just, like, tears people down on their image.
Yeah.
But, like, I don't know. I don't know. That's a really, like, whoa. I really don't know. Well, like, if I take a photo of myself and then my friend sees it, they're like, oh, my God, post that. And I just think, okay, like, why not? You know? I don't know.
So it's just it's your mates.
Peer pressure.
No, it's not peer pressure. If I want to post it, I will. But like, I always have to ask people before I post something because I get like scared. You know?
So peer pressure. So what makes you look at a photo and think, right, I'm gonna send this to my mate and make sure that they think this is like ready to post on social media?
Well, I do it with almost any like video of myself or any photo of myself. Like whenever I, well, you don't have me on Snapchat, but Spencer, whenever I post like a video of me on my private or my main, I always confide my friends with it first because I physically can't do it without their opinion. Not like I can do stuff on my own. That makes me sound really dependent on others, but like, I don't know, I get really scared of what I look like, so I just have to make sure I look presentable, you know?
So you want approval from others before you present your own image?
To others?
Yeah.
It's like you're getting a pre-approval before getting the mass approval.
Yeah, like a secret approval. Social media post, yeah.
We cracked the code.
Huh?
We've cracked the code.
What do you mean?
No, carry on.
What do you mean? Okay. I asked like my close. It's only gonna be like two people. I don't really have that many friends. I've asked like one or two people if I look okay. I just say like, do I look okay? And like if they say no, then I'll just take it down. You know?
What are you worried about? What's like? What do you mean not look okay?
No, because like. I don't know. Like. I don't know how to explain it, but like if I look bad, you know.
Yeah, but that's subjective, yeah.
So you're trying to think about you looking bad in the if you were talking from the perspective of someone who, you know, just a random stranger who might scroll across your picture, or are you talking about bad from a personal perspective? So you look like the same way that you might look in the mirror one day and be like, I look bad today.
Well, I look in the mirror like every day and I just think, and like, I don't know, it's weird. Like, even though I know I look bad on like most of my posts, I just keep it up anyway because others seem to like it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So you're trying to please others, not yourself.
With your own image.
With your own image, yeah.
Well, I've sort of changed it now. Like, I don't know how to explain it. This is really confusing me.
No,
like,
I know. I think it's quite a deep-rooted and...
That's why we've chosen the topic as well.
Yeah, weirdly enough, I think now it's kind of like a reflexive thing. Like, you can just tell what you want to post, and there's no reason why. It's just sort of like an instinct. But it's weird. That's weird. That's why we want to talk about it.
Yeah. Like... like, some days, I'll just be looking at, like, photos of me, and I think... oh, I'll just post it. So I get a spur of the moment, like being brave, and I just post it and I just leave it. But then other times I'm like insecure. I hate that word. But yeah, it varies.
What has caused you to be insecure?
Probably, I don't know, myself? I don't know. That's a weird question.
No, because you yourself can't cause yourself to become insecure, if that makes sense. You have to get you have to see something or get influence from someone else to be insecure. You can't just randomly you can't feel insecure when you have nothing to compare to, you know what I mean? If you're feeling insecure, that means you've compared. Because otherwise, how are you gonna be insecure?
Well, basically just people around me, like my friends or like people I see on social media, I just think, oh, they're really pretty, oh, their nose is smaller than mine, like, oh, all this stuff, you know.
Really?
Do you not do that?
No. It might like.
It's a new girl thing then.
No, I do.
Think my friends do it. Like.
I think I take it into consideration, but I don't think it's something that. Obviously, I don't know. I think personally, when I'm posted on something on Instagram, right, I don't look at it and think, oh man, I don't look. I like sometimes I don't look good. I don't look great. I might be like, I don't look great compared to, you know, this person, or I might feel a little bit rough about what I'm, you know, the way I'm looking. But you know, personally, I want to, you know, show sort of solidarity within myself and be like, oh, you know, it doesn't really matter what anyone else thinks. You know, I'm posting it because I want to share something with my friends, like a moment of experience or something that's happened, and I want to share it with my friends. I want to share it with myself to sort of like, you know, just be like, you know, this is what's happening. It's almost like a diary. But I get what you mean. I understand that it's definitely a huge issue with social media. I mean, it's been spoken about a lot. You know, the idea of these influencers setting these false standards, these unrealistic standards, it's really, really unhealthy, I think.
Yeah.
It just links back to people, like, chasing numbers, like, chasing that virtual instant gratification of that like. It's almost like imagine you have 100 likes. That's like 100 people coming up to you saying, oh, you look good. It's almost like an online verification saying, good job, mate.
Yeah, literally. Yeah.
So, sorry, I just want to say, what Viraj said in the chat, jealousy is one of the things that he feels like. He's the guy that, well, he sees, like Sas said, sees other people's pics. He gets jealous, which is...
That's natural.
Yeah, that's natural.
I
can relate 100%.
I think it's natural to social media, because so maybe an example that we could relate to. So if you see on Instagram like a really, really well, like a buff, really, really buff guy, right?
Yep.
He's very like worked out, spent a lot of time, put a lot of effort, and he showed a picture of like, you know, his body, and you think, damn, I wish I could look like that.
Yeah.
And it just will make you don't take into consideration what's going through his head, or the journey he's made to get to that point, or the effort he's put into, you know, or the time, the effort, the money, just everything that has gone into looking that way. All you're doing is saying, like, that's his post and that's my post. And you're like, you just sort of put them in a hierarchy. You're just like, okay, well, my post is clearly just not on par with it, I think.
Yeah, I agree to some extent, because I agree, I do get a jealousy, but I always ask for some, like, not for some reason, but recently, or this year, I've been, every time I see something, I ask why. Like, why? Like, there's always a why for someone or something, right? And so, like you said, we don't know his why, but I always ask it, and you can, there's usually a lot of reasons. Like, sometimes people have been overweight, right? Prime example, Raj, he came on the podcast with us, he was overweight, and he's so determined to get into shape, because he was so motivated by seeing everyone else and seeing like the benefits of being in shape, health wise and obviously social wise as well. Like, if we're being honest, like, I feel like a lot of people that are in shape are more likely to be, I'm sure there's a study on this, but more likely to be approached, or it's easier to approach people when you're in shape rather than overweight. Unfortunately, that's the thing.
I think that's just generally with people who think, you know, it's just generally the perception of people on the scale of good looking to bad looking.
Yeah.
People are always more likely to approach someone who's good looking. Always.
Yeah. It's like a
natural instinctive thing.
But the whole point I'm trying to make is good looking does involve weight, and so you're right. So so the whole point, he said, it's promoting that industry, if that makes sense, because you want to achieve that since he done it. Yeah, exactly. So that's what I'm saying. So when I look at a picture like that, I'm asking, okay, why? I might not be able to see as why. But then you ask yourself, why can I not do it? If you're motivated to do it, that should be your motivation. Be like, if he's done it, I can do it. You know? Bro, you good?
I totally understand what you mean, though. But I think I was just thinking of it more on like this very snapped sort of decision emotion that you get. So you might be working towards a similar goal, but you might be going to the gym every day doing 2 hours a day workouts, and you might actually be making progress, and realistically from someone else's perspective you might not be far behind. But all it takes is, you know, seeing someone else be there already, and you're like, okay, you have that sort of jealousy, you know. It's just like you see the love and the likes and the comments that they get, and you're like, shit, man, is this, you know, I need to get there. And it's like, it's not dissuading you from reaching these goals. And you can ask the question, why? And you can be like, okay, well, now I want to get to that place. But it's not what I'm trying to make a point of is that, you know, the emotional impact and the mental impact it has on you in that split second of seeing it, be like, okay, I'm not there. You can't help but compare yourself to that. You can't be like, okay, she's got a shit ton of likes, he's got a shit ton of likes. Compare it to me, not that much. And you just sort of like it. It's like this subconscious thing. I think you just put yourself down.
You're really right, support. But the scary thing is, people will genuinely see these things, get jealous, like you said, and only solely get in shape just to get likes, which is vile. Because if you're basing your life around a virtual number, that's not healthy. Like, that's got to change, because
it's so real. So
yeah,
real.
Because that happens so much, and we see it so often. It's scary, and that's like I think, like you said, we just need to use that jealousy in a positive way rather than a negative way. Well, we like the other alternative that to what I was saying is people get jealous, and guess what? It'll make them upset. It'll make them feel down because they're not there and they are, you know?
Yeah.
Remember back to the beginning of the podcast, we talked about Instagram, you know, we thought it was just for food and right? For food, like posting pictures of food. I feel like the basis of Instagram was designed to people to post pictures, and the like feature is almost like for you to get rewarded for the work you've done. So you've done a sick painting, post that, you know, loads of likes, perfect. You know, you cook some fire dish, loads of likes. And it's almost like in the last couple of years, we've seen these quote-unquote social media influencers that are in shape, they look good, and they've almost like taken over the market. And like, if you go on your search feed, right, most of the time it will be like, girls or boys like topless or like looking good, right? And that's because I think the whole ideal, maybe it's not, maybe it's just me being biased. Maybe it's just my local search. Yeah.
It's based on
shit, guys.
topless girls on your feet.
But
self first, I like it.
Brilliant.
So what I'm trying to say is it's almost gone from like hard work in your work is gone. It's more to do with the hard work in your body image. So it's almost like they're trying to put out that perfect body image, and it puts people down because all the likes now are going to people that have better bodies.
And well, I think it's just, I agree with you, but I think it's more like, you know, people. So if someone looks good and they want to be told that they look good because that feels good. And Instagram is a platform where you can share a picture and you can get likes. And they're like, okay, they put two and two together. I'm going to put a picture of me looking good on there. And then suddenly, you know, get all these numbers. And then as soon as that happens, it's done. Like, that's hooked. They're reeled in. Because now you know if you put a picture up, there's at least someone out there that will like it and will give you that endorphin rush. And it's this whole sort of cycle of becoming hooked on it, and then depending on it for self-confidence. So yeah. without that, you feel like, you know, if you're not posting, then you feel like, oh god, you know, maybe I'm losing my good looks, maybe I'm losing my style, maybe I'm losing my shape, I'm gonna you know, get more approval because it's easy. That's the whole thing. Social media is so easy.
Instant gratification,
it's easy and it's instant and it's boom and it's really quick, really sorted, which is an issue. Like, it's an issue with anything, especially relating to endorphins. As soon as you get a quick fix, all you need, you know, that just scales up. You just need more and more and more and more. It's not really mentally healthy to be able to have that. Especially when you're relating it to stuff like self body image. I think.
Yeah, ultimately, yeah. You've hit the nail on the head. I wanted to talk about what you said before, Sass, as well, where you said you had a private and a main. And I know this is common with most people now, but I just wanted to touch on it because I think it's an important part of social media as well. And I just want to hear why do you have a private, and why do you have a private and a main?
Also, maybe explain the concept
of private. Oh yeah.
Oh right. So my private is just me being me, like my actual personality, which is different to how I perceive myself on my main. Not in a bad way, but like on my main, I get a lot of people who meet me for the first time saying like, oh, I thought you were really boring. Like, I thought you were really stuck up, like from your Instagram, from your Snapchat, but you're really not. And like, so my private is just me just having fun, basically posting whatever I want. Like, I put stuff on there to help people, like quotes and stuff if they're like going through a rough time. Like, I don't know, it's just me being me, I guess.
See, that's so... And I'm not, I'm obviously, Saskia, no dig on you at all.
Yeah, I know.
I have a private Snapchat story, so it's pretty much the same thing. But isn't it so weird that we find this need to, you know, social media is a perfect way to show your presentation, present your personality to the world. Yet you have this very, very secret group who are the only ones who can actually see the unfiltered personality. And then you have this completely other personality, which is what other people see.
I'll combat this up because there's a boundary, right? There's something called the social norms in psychology where you have to follow these social norms in order to be viewed as, quote, I'm going to do quote-unquote normal or average in society, right? And so some of the stuff that we might put on our private, like same as me, I don't want to show some of the stuff that I have in my private to the public world, right?
Yeah.
Not because I'm naked or anything, unfortunately, but it's because it's private to me and my friends. Like it's almost like I only want them to see, not because I'm scared of anyone else of seeing it, for the fact that I have a different personality. It's just the fact that I just want those eyes seeing it as it's probably as an experience to do with them and me, and so we can all relate to it, rather than I don't know, some fucking Bob and Jerry mate looking at my Snapchat story or something of me like doing something crazy, you know?
No, it totally makes sense, you're right.
That's the reason why I have a private, like, is to keep those memories and experiences that I shared with the people that only follow it. I don't want, and obviously there's probably stuff on there that isn't good to look in a public eye, right? I'm not saying I'm naked or anything, but
I completely understand because, sorry, I don't want to cut you off.
No,
continue. I was just going to say, like, the problem, I think the thing is, the reason this has happened is because social media isn't this group, your social media isn't constricted to your group of close friends. It is basically a group of, you know, people that you either have known, have met, have talked to in some quantity over whatever period of time that you have that account. You're never going to be your complete self to some, like, you don't, even in person, you go and see an old classmate in real life. You're going to be very, you know, you're following social traditions. You'll be like, oh, you know, how are you? How's the family? Blah, 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 blah. What are you doing nowadays? That sort of thing. You know, it's a procedure. Like, it's a socially expected procedure almost. And I'm not trying to make it like robotic. I'm just saying that it's just what most people do. You know, you don't like go up to them and you're, you know, telling them all these weird personal anecdotes that you've just experienced because they have no context. They don't know you that well. And they might be on your Snapchat, that old classmate. They might be on your Facebook. Obviously, you're not going to be acting that way. You're going to present yourself in a more professional way. It's funny because social media now, like a main account or a Facebook account, is basically you during that, the representation of you during that polite interaction with someone you haven't seen for a long time.
Yeah, literally, yeah.
And then the private is basically just genuinely the representation of a real you for your close friends.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, you're right. Because it's almost like, link it again to the podcast name, it's behind closed doors. It's what's happening behind closed doors.
Always slip it in there somewhere.
I know, mate. hold on. I'm not going to... Right, yeah. It's like you said, it's your real self, your real, I guess, ego, or your real persona is your private. But
yeah,
I use my main on Instagram and stuff. It's just to update my life on what and people that I haven't seen.
It's just because the scale of social media that has come to you. Like maybe back in the day, you did just have your close friends on Facebook, and maybe you could share and say and do stuff that was genuinely a representation of yourself. But the scale of it nowadays, like you said, 2.6 billion monthly users.
Yeah, that's mad.
And the fact that all those people could have, if they search your name, they have access to at least some information on you, depending on your privacy settings. Obviously, you're not going to be reflecting your true, unfiltered personality. like where you, the one that you are exhibiting when you're with, when you're with someone you're comfortable with. It's not, it couldn't, it doesn't work. So in terms of how we act in person, in society, it makes sense. So social media is basically a mirror now of how we act with people.
You're right, yeah.
It's pretty different, but I think for a lot of people, for like myself included, my Instagram, you know, complete, you don't want to put in, you don't want to put offensive stuff or, you know, slightly risky jokes or, you know, anything like that. You don't show that to the outside world because there are so many people who I'm not very personal or not very close with who are going to see it. So it's just like, you know, it's this, it's a reflection of how we act, who we are, how we are in real life. I think.
Yeah, I get what you mean. Like, let's say I meet someone that I haven't seen from school for a while. I'm not going to be my exact self that I am with my friends. It's almost like we've just adapted as humans just to... I'm not saying I'd be more hostile, but I'd be just friendly and nice, but I wouldn't be, like, my true self just because...
No,
not, that's what I'm saying. It must link to, like, being comfortable. Like, you don't know them as well, so you're not as comfortable around them. It must
that's
be
exactly
that.
What I'm saying. It must just be. It's just this level of social interaction, how it works, and, you know, the way that we exhibit our personality with our friends, etc. Because social media nowadays, it isn't a way to share with your friends. It's a way to basically market yourself on the internet, your personality. That's it.
Yep. And it's become a dangerous game now, though, because obviously we have these influencers. And the whole sort of idea of clout, like people with millions of followers, and people the idea of people, and I feel like this is it's very valid to Sass's age range and people even below. People's dreams are to become an influencer of some sort, like, are to become...
Do you think?
100%.
Do you dream to become an influencer?
No, definitely. A lot of people in my year want to become an influencer.
100%.
What, like, as like an end game, like a goal for their life? Jesus, yeah. Really?
Because think about it, bro.
Quite a lot, to be fair. They get paid for posting a picture on Instagram, like... Loads of people want to be that, especially my
because
age.
Guess what? It links back to instant gratification, instant money, instant likes, instant everything, bro.
Yeah,
and it's like, it's vile because it's not safe.
Vile.
It's not vile. That's the wrong word. It's the wrong word.
Unhealthy.
My bad. That's very bad. It's very unhealthy. That's the word. Because it's scary that we're slowly turning into people that are chasing virtual numbers. But then again, we could argue about this all day, like, money's quote-unquote a virtual number, like fuck this, we're not going to do that. We're not going to talk about that now, but... to me, that's scary. Like we don't know this, Finn, but yeah, people younger than us, their dreams are to become an influencer. Whether that be just a genuine influencer or, like, a YouTuber or something like that along the lines, you know?
No, I understand the appeal, right? Of
same, yeah.
Posting money, but I would never be like, oh, I no longer want to have a career. I no longer want to have a steady job and a job that I enjoy. I just want to post pictures of myself online and get paid for it. I don't think that's crazy to me that people actually want that.
Yeah, but I guess it just comes down to their use of social media and how they've been influenced on social media. At such a young age, and the younger you are, the more impressionable you are. So, people getting access to social media at younger and younger ages is not good. Like, I've seen toddlers play with iPads. Obviously, they're not on social media, but the fact that we're getting so comfortable with technology at a young age is scary to me.
I agree. It's rough.
Whoa. That was a good mind blown there.
Whoa, was it? You reckon it was a bit of a...
I was just sort of gaining the information we just talked about.
All right, yeah, no, I get you. I think it's tricky because it is addictive as well, fundamentally. Like, the amount of times I pick up my phone, like, it's funny because I deleted Now, I've had you know, people go through these detox periods from social media.
Yeah.
Which is funny, like detox from social media, like it's alcohol, and they delete the app, and it's funny because I deleted Instagram for a bit, and then I find myself just like absentmindedly just picking up my phone. And I go to the exact space that Instagram should be on.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, fuck, it's not there. And I've literally just, look, this is, it's, I've not even thought about it. I haven't had stimulation in my brain for 1 second, and then I've gone to pick it up because it's so instant. Because I can literally look on that page and be like, I can find something I like. Boom. This isn't even just talk about posting, this is talk about just being an observer. But, you just find some information, or you'll see your picture, your mate's picture. You're like, oh, cool, like, done. Second, it's back down, boom, and it's addictive. It's so addictive, and it's, I hate that I'm addicted to it. I really do, but I also am not in this current situation willing to forego this interactivity that I have with my friends and the happiness that it brings to be able to share everything with my friends at the click of a button.
Yeah, like you're talking about memes, I'm guessing, and stuff like that.
I mean, yeah, you could generalize it down to memes.
But yeah, I get you.
It's deeper than that. Like I could delete Snapchat, and I could delete Messenger, and I could delete Instagram, but then I'd be texting people. Like I could.
What's the point of that though? I think going that bare bones in this day and age is dumb, in my opinion.
I don't think it's dumb. I think it's just this reliance. No, but it's just this reliance. It's the gratification.
The thing that's helped me is you gotta treat your phone like a drug. Like you said, it's addicting. Like the best way to do it is control how you're using it.
Yeah, but we're too late.
Because I've done it recently, bro. My screen time is down so much, bro. I use my phone an hour, maybe 2 hours a day max.
Oh.
And this is why. I'll tell you why. My phone is completely broken right now. Right. Like. I can't use a top.
That's not a tactic.
Bro,
it's
not a tactic, but this is what happened. This is my experience, right? So I can't use a top, I just got the bottom, right? So what happens? I can hardly use my screen. I can't be bothered to go on my phone because I can't use it. And so I've seen myself become more productive in other ways because I'm not on my phone as much.
Yeah, but what's happening there is you're benefiting from an unintentional
accident.
Whereas I'm not going to smash my phone. And I would have to take, deliberate action to try and do the same thing.
But then, if you really wanted to, I guess you could install these apps that prevent you from going on your phone for certain hours.
They don't work. I've tried.
Well, then the best thing to do as well is if you go out, just leave your phone in.
No, because then what if something happens? What if you want to, like, what if you need something?
Yeah, there's an emergency.
Oh, I guess that's true.
Because fundamentally, a phone is contact to so many people in the world, even if you take social media away. So, like, you know what? Tell you what, I might buy a brick phone, right?
Yeah, bro. Just buy a
pay-as-you-go contract.
Yeah.
Just take that out, put all the necessary numbers in, and then, it, you know, needs be, use that instead. Because at the moment, I just need so much stimulation in my life through all things that I'm doing. Every activity has to be, you know, constantly feeding me information or giving me something to do. Otherwise I need another source. It's like people watching TV and being on their phones at the same time, because watching the TV isn't enough. It's not stimulating enough. So you'll watch the TV and you'll scroll through your phone, and I'll do it too. And it's this whole, you know, you need to absorb more information and have more stimulus and have more endorphin rushes.
But then you could agree that you're not really watching that program. You're not indulged enough. To me, like if you're in the cinema, you're not on your phone.
Not. I'll look up and I'll watch it, and then I'll go back to the feed and I'll look up and I'll watch it.
But that means you're not totally into it.
No, I could tell you. Yeah, of course I'm not. But that's not relevant. That's not the point. Point is that I'm consuming two things at once.
But is that just because you're bored?
I think bored is dramatic. I'd just say less stimulated than I want to be. Less interested.
I've been kept. Yeah. I mean, you're not. I've seen Sass do that as well. Like, she's watching Netflix. She just goes on her phone.
A lot of people do it. Most people who have social media do it. And I would put a bet on to say that you've done it at least once.
Of course I've done it. Yeah, I'm not saying I haven't, but of course. But for me, it's like recently I do something on my monitor. If I'm watching a TV program, I've got a TV on there, and I'm doing something on here, whether it's playing something or editing something, do whatever. Like you said, I guess because we just want that sort of extra stimulus, or even like that just background noise of
yeah,
you're right.
Because we're too accustomed to having too much information. Like information is too easy to get, or stimulus is too easy to acquire. So why wouldn't you have another screen with a TV program so that when your current action or interaction has like a lapse in interest, you can just switch over. Like, okay, watching TV program, now back to this. Because it's the whole thing. It's instant gratification. Same thing as social media. We're too used to that instant fix and the whatever you want when you want it, right now.
Yeah. To be fair, one tip I actually do use still is I've turned my notifications off on Instagram, and it's actually made me use it a lot less. So you might want to do that. Then,
I was tempted to do that for Snapchat, to be honest with you.
I did it for Snapchat as well, but it bit me in the bum.
That's a whole other thing.
I don't know. For Snapchat, I don't agree, because that's a main messaging source for me. So let's say something important happens and I need to know about it, I've missed it because I don't have my notification on.
But that's the thing.
Really?
That's just...
Yeah.
I get what you mean, though. Because
do they not just text you?
My texts don't work, and if it's very important, right, they'll ring me. But sometimes, like, people are scared to ring. Like, people might ring on Snapchat and I don't get the notification. Like, I've had that multiple times.
Right.
I mean, this is just from personal experience. I've had
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
I know what you mean. I do, because... But then that comes to this whole issue of, you know, 10 years ago, it was... If you couldn't get a hold of someone, you couldn't get a hold of someone. That was it.
Yeah.
You do the next thing, and that's normal. But now, there are like 12 different ways to get a hold of someone. It's like, oh, you know, so and so's not replying. So, like, all right, cool. Fucking Instagram message him, Snapchat him, email him, Facebook message him,
email him, bro.
Like WhatsApp him, everything. And it's just too easy. It's too. You're expected to be so attentive, and you're expected to be able to interact with via social media, via devices, via technology at any time. It all fits in with this instant fix thing.
Yeah.
Everything's too at your fingertips. Like, we're spoiled.
We are spoiled. And to be fair, I've also taken a page out of Diogo's book, because obviously Diogo is one of our mates.
Oh, I thought you said Diogo.
No, Diogo is renowned for the slowest Snapchat responses ever.
That is awful, yeah.
But I've taken a tactic from him, and I've reduced my time on Snapchat and opening it when it's convenient for me. I know this is a selfish way to look at it, but if I always open if I always open it when it's convenient for them, I'm on it way more often, I've noticed. So if I'm doing something and I need to put my full focus, I will. And I've actually like started to put myself in a more selfish way of like not opening it until I'm ready to look at messages, you know what I mean? Even if it might be perceived as I'm not doing anything, I'm in like a flow of state of mind of doing in the middle of something. Maybe I'm sitting in my chair, like just watching something. I don't want to look at messages right now because I'm trying to retain information from something, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And that's something that Diogo does. He doesn't do it until the end of the day when he wants to look at messages. Like he wants to rather than he feels forced to. And I think that's a key thing to take away.
That's the thing, it's something we've had to adapt to because we're not used to not having Diogo interactions at our fingertips anymore. But now we know. Now we know he just does. If you don't get hold of if you want to get hold of Diogo during the day, you're not getting hold of him.
Good luck, mate. You gotta ring him, bro. You gotta ring him.
You got mail. You got some mail. You'll go to his house and knock on his door.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we're back in the '90s.
Yeah, but
Diogo doesn't function like that. You fax him at the end of the day, that's it.
You have to give him a 24-hour warning and then be like, yo, message me noon the next day.
You're like, Diogo, I need something important for you tomorrow. So be on your phone. He'd be like, mate, I don't know, I can't promise it. But that's just how it is. And one thing I was wondering, right?
Yeah,
sorry,
yeah.
I don't know.
No, go for it.
I don't know if you're still in the flow. I was just going to ask you, Do you sit and wait for notifications on your phone?
No, I don't talk to anyone.
That's a lie and a half. That's the biggest lie.
Oh, right now. The amount of notifications I have, I don't open anyone's snaps, especially if they haven't messaged me before. I reply to like close friends. If it's really important, they'll literally text me or ring me and say, just go on Snapchat. And I'll say, okay. But I literally don't either. If I need something, then yeah, fair enough. But like, whenever I go on Snapchat, I just go on it to text on my private story or my private. And I just don't. Like, right now, I've just so unopened snaps, like, I can't be bothered. Do you know what I mean?
So, I want to challenge this, I'm ready. I think, okay. I don't want to sound like a dick, but, like, no, I feel like, yeah, I know I am. It's like, when people don't, let's say, people are on their phone actively, right?
Yeah.
I used to care about this, like, last year, I don't give a shit anymore. But, people... like, or somehow gain a feeling of like superiority when they don't open snaps, and so they have all these open snaps, right?
It's a power thing.
Yeah, it's like it is because they open their phone and they see, right, I'm wanted by about 20 people, I'm not gonna fucking open them, and it's not it's something that's come up with this newer generation. No, it's fine, you might not think like that, but it's definitely. I just wanted to see why. So your main reason to not opening these snaps from people that you have never talked to, maybe. What if they're important? You know, like why are you not?
Someone I don't speak to that much be like messaging me something important. Do you know what I mean?
That's the whole point. Because they haven't messaged. They don't message you often. So like the one time they pop up, it might be like shit. I need help or something.
It does sound very rude of me. Like I know, but I'm quite. I don't know. I used to not be like this at all. I think. It only happened last year at the end of summer. I started to become like this. I never sent streaks. Like, I'd always send them really badly. I don't do streaks anymore because it's just so much effort to me. Like, speaking to people, I just don't like speaking to people on the phone. I know that sounds really rude, but I just, like, I don't know. If they have something important to say, like, spam me, but, like, I just don't like it anymore. I'm really antisocial. I just don't like talking to people.
That's so backwards, though. You're saying for someone to get you, they have to spam you to get your attention.
Yeah, well, I'm
but then you're being fed more messages.
And you're being fed more messages.
More unopened like notifications, more unopened messages. Then to like, and then you're setting yourself back. No.
Yeah, that's true. Some days I have to, like, force myself to open it, and there's some, like, from 22 weeks ago, and I just...
What? What?
That's the thing
bro,
I could never...
Bro, that's not fair. Like, if someone...
Honestly, if I see an unopened message, I have to open it.
Yeah, literally. Really? Oh, my God. I always put myself in someone's shoes. If I hadn't opened a snap for 10 hours, I'd be like, fuck. Like, I'm so sorry. Unless I'm really busy that day, I'm so sorry.
So sorry.
Like, 22 weeks, I'd be fuming. Because
it's
they...
just streaks. I don't care about streaks.
Okay, streaks may be fair enough, but it's almost like the situation with Boy Who Cried Wolf, right? So let's say, obviously, you're so used to streaks. That one time they send you an important message like, I need help or something, you left it 22 weeks.
You can blue message me. Like, why send me...
Blue message. because you wouldn't know if they blue message you, because when they send you a snap, the red one covers the blue one.
True.
Oh, that's now we're getting
all the time.
That defeats the point, though. That defeats the point.
Yeah, we're getting deep into it, into the whole like, you know, nitty gritty.
But yeah, to me, being you, I think that the main benefit, obviously, of social media. Is the communication that it has allowed us to have. Like you said, yeah. 10 years ago...
Just ease of information access.
Exactly. 10 years ago, we would not be able to do what we can do now, which is sick. Yeah. In terms of communication with not only your friends, but the whole world. Like, on Instagram, we can scroll through and see the whole world going on, you know, like the riots in other countries. The protests.
Otherwise, you have to get the newspaper.
Exactly.
And even then, it's doctored. Like...
Yeah, and then even then, it's still like to go get a newspaper, we need to go to the shop, bloody buy a newspaper and come back home and read it. Whereas yeah, this, I can roll out of bed and see shit. China's had an earthquake, you know, like something nuts like that.
Yeah.
I think it's insane how developed we've come in that communication aspect. But I think it's about us finding a balance as humans of when to use it, and we're still figuring it out.
I think we will reach a time when it's been around for long enough and we've not sort of seen any like big progressions. So something like going from text to go to having something like Snapchat is like a decently sized step, right?
Yep.
In terms of difference of communication and level of information you get, like a whole picture and that. So I think once we're used to social media and having this instant contact and instant information, we've had it around for a longer time, I reckon it will balance out and there'll be a more steady sort of, you know, distribution of people who, you know, are basically living like Diogo, and then more people who are still, you know, you know, they're accessible and you message them and they're replying in a minute. Like, there will be a more even distribution of people because it will become like the norm. Because right now, the idea that I feel like, even though it's been around, people say, you know, it's been around for years now. Yeah, it has. But the idea that you get instant information is still pretty new, and it's still quite a, you know, it's still something that people get hooked on.
Oh, Sass is frozen in a nice position.
Yeah, she has just dipped out.
Oh, there you go. He's like,
ugh. Yeah, sorry, I like, cut out for like ages.
Yeah, I agree with the fact that we're still in the early stages of, like you said, of this instant access to knowledge.
Yeah.
I'm just worried at the moment because I feel like it's getting worse for the younger generations because 100%. Because they have so much time compared to, let's just say, adults, that they're always on their phone. I reckon if you look at someone's screen time, especially during lockdown, I mean, lockdown's an unfair example, but even out of lockdown, I feel like a lot of people's screen time would be easily above 6 hours. And in my opinion, that's, if you put that as perspective, right, 6 hours a day, right, on your phone, looking at a screen, come on, that would scare me. Like,
it's funny because it's like this whole, you know, we would sound like such old people being like, oh, you're on your phone too much, like, but
yeah,
it's true. Like, the idea that they've got nothing, you know, instead of doing whatever we did when we were that age, you know, playing Pokemon trading cards or whatever, and, you know, going outside. I'm not saying people don't go outside at whatever age they are now, like, obviously they do, but yeah, I agree with you. Just being able to instead be like, oh no, I don't want to do that. I don't want to go outside, or I don't want to go play, or I don't want to do this because I can just message so and so, or I can watch this video on YouTube, or I can read this article, or I can scroll through Instagram. Like, it's too easy, and we're a lazy species. We're lazy.
I mean, it's because the tools we've been given are making us more and more lazy, and I feel like eventually we'll just end up like the people at Wally, like the people
in the chairs. Yeah, I knew you were going to say that. Just floating around in these reclined armchairs, like, overweight.
Everything's done for us. Well, I challenge you both quick to go on your phone and check your screen time for today. I want to see.
Actually, I reckon I'll be alright.
I think mine's very respectable. Go in settings.
Might be an Android thing.
Nah, it's definitely not. It's definitely not.
Oh.
What you got, Saz? Wait.
I don't know. It's not saying anything. Oh, it's updating.
Right.
I don't know it. What?
All right. While you sort that out, mine. I've got a solid 3 hours and 26 minutes. I think that's respectable. But I also did a bit of trading on my phone, which I usually do. So I reckon I'd have an average about 2 and a bit hours. But today I was 3.5.
3.5.
Yep.
I've actually got 3 hours 28 minutes.
Oh, you literally got 2 minutes more than me, bro. That's respectable.
Have you got this? What it's split up into?
Yeah, Snapchat's an hour for me. But I think I know why, but yeah.
I've got 32 minutes on Snapchat.
Really? I've got double that. But
I've got quite a lot on Instagram. I've got like 35 on Instagram.
Fair enough.
But what? So, have you got how many? I've got how many notifications I've had?
Yeah, 524.
How many? What?
524. 579. Oh shit, Ray.
How many unlocks?
82.
303.
No. You're just sat there going unconsciously opening it, bro.
Especially, right? I got my fingerprint scanner right.
Yeah,
on the
same,
back.
Same.
I pick up my phone and it just bang. I'm in. And it's like, oh shit. I've just unlocked it again. Boom. And it's
dangerous, bro. So, I think the best thing to do is just put your phone out of reach. That's another tactic. Like, just leave it like the side and make you have to get it rather than putting it in your pocket.
To be fair, today I was quite good with that. Like, my phone's on charge, and usually I don't like not being about without my phone in my pocket. But I put it on charge in my room, and I went and I was downstairs just like doing whatever, just not caring about it. And it felt quite nice, you know, not having to be like, oh, do I have to reply to that message, or do I have to worry about doing this? It's just like, okay, disconnected for a little while, let's just relax.
Yeah, I think it's nice to disconnect every now and then, but at the end of the day, I feel like disconnecting for too long, especially in our day and age, is dangerous because you just become out of the loop of everything.
I don't know if it's dangerous, it's just different. It's not, I don't think it's not a risk.
I think it's dangerous for, I guess I'm speaking on behalf of Diogo, but I feel like it's dangerous for him because I haven't properly spoken to him for 3 months, bro.
No, neither have I.
And that's like, maybe if he's in issues, he's like maybe thinking, oh, fuck, I haven't talked to properly anyone in ages. Like, maybe they don't like me anymore, you know? That's just something he could be thinking. Obviously, I don't know. But that's why I think it's dangerous.
But that's just this whole idea that because of social media, people have this idea that they need to constantly be checking up.
They don't need to be constantly.
No, but conversations have to be flowing with mates, you know? Whereas... otherwise, you know, in 10 years ago, we would have just waited until we next saw Diogo.
Yeah, but it wouldn't. I feel like 3 months is very long, you know.
I feel like, but only because of the context, bro, of, you know, the accessibility that we have now.
Yeah, I guess that's true, and it's also because of the current situations, coronavirus, etc.
Yeah,
that's,
exactly.
Yeah. I guess it's not a good example. Sas, what's your screen time, mate?
Me, because I reset my phone a couple days ago, so I'm guessing I didn't update it. So it says 2 minutes because it started literally 2 minutes ago.
Oh,
you've already been on it for 2 minutes, and then you just updated it. Jesus Christ!
No,
we're on a podcast. Come on,
it's ridiculous.
Mate, I was trying to get it to work. I didn't know. I didn't understand why it said zero.
Oh yeah, you like, definitely weren't messaging no one. Were.
Okay.
All right. Let's.
No, I was messing. We're just messing.
Bring another piece. Yeah. I feel like I've ranted enough about social media.
I've enjoyed that.
I just want to make it clear. Yes, I'm a hypocrite. Yes, I do use it a lot. There you are. Yeah, that's it. Pretty much. Nothing much.
Same with me. Like, I don't think I'm a hypocrite, but I do. I am. I do use. I'm an avid user of it. So, but what I think I want to just bring to light is just be wary of how you're using it.
I tell you what. Tomorrow I'm gonna turn off my notifications. I'm just gonna like.
Don't. I say try it instead first.
Nah. Turn it off.
Okay. Go for it, bro.
I will.
Any last thoughts, Sas?
Really, no.
Did you enjoy the social media, the debate?
Yes.
Did that open your mind a bit?
Yeah.
That's a no.
That was a no, yeah. You look a bit angry, you look a bit vexed.
Yeah.
Me?
Yeah.
That's just my face.
Oh.
I literally look angry all the time.
Fair enough. All right. Thank you, ladies and gents. Oh. That was a good session.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, mate.